start. This is my name, Hamza Alsayouf, and I work in the new health for GIT. Unfortunately, till now it's not open. It will open soon. We have been working on that for the last 9 months, and hopefully it's not going to take more than a few weeks more. And this is our website, American Tribunal UAE, that we will talk about later on. Can you hear me very well?
Yes.
Okay. Now today, we're going to talk about pediatric epilepsy, and we're going to talk about the paroxysmal non-epileptic spells in children. I'm just going to give you an overview. I did my medical school at Georgia University of Science and Technology, and I did my pediatric training at Texas Tech University, so you can notice I latched on the Texan accent early on. I got also my child neurology training at Ohio State University Nationwide Children's Hospital. I worked in the child neurologist at Mercy Catholic Hospital, DMO in Iowa, and there was a consultant child neurologist at Norfolk Hospital in Abu Dhabi for 1.5 years, and then decided to move to Dubai. Now, this is a Canadian Lung Association. They will always tell you, if you cannot breathe, nothing else matters. As a neurologist, I usually would tell you, and I strongly back up my word, if you lose your mind, nothing else matters. So that is why neurology is really, really important, because your brain dictates what you do in life. Now, Canadian Lung Association also tell you smoking will kill you, so don't do smoking. Don't enjoy smoking. In neurology, we tell you, please, enjoy marijuana. It's it is a treatment for seizure. So stick to neurology, we always have you guys. All right, now epilepsy. That is probably the bread and butter of what we do in the practice. I'm going to start first with the what is epilepsy. Epilepsy is, as a definition, is recurrent unprovoked seizure. So it should not be provoked. And the seizure is a transient abnormal hypersynchronous neuronal discharge that can be associated with the clinical signs and might not be associated with the clinical signs. Just, you know, to set the stage for the talk. So basically, your neurons gone wild. That is a seizure. Now here, I want you guys to watch this video, and I want to tell me what you guys think is what do you think is this? I want it to be very interactive. This is a guy, you know, he's not doing. I'm sorry, it is what you're playing here, but not playing on the screen.
Monitor only, you can play here and one play here.
Huh?
Try to do this one, four, and then it will play only here, but you may lose it there.
Yeah, so how can you
go on that? Try this.
So I play it like this. Okay. Thank you, Muhammad. So I want you to watch this guy and see he's sitting down. He's having an EEG done, and it's not a haircut. And this guy is doing his EEG, and the guy start to have something. And I thought he was going to do something. Probably change his mind, but he's going to come. All of a sudden, this guy starts, you know, hit the drop, start jerking. The other guys, basically, I don't think he ever had bowels. He, you know, suffocated him and holding him down. So after you see this guy, what do you think is your diagnosis? This is a patient, partial onset seizure, start jerking one hand. This is a generalized onset seizure, all of a sudden collapse. It is psychogenic. He is basically, it's all in his head. It is syncopal attack, or you can say, I want to ask a friend, but it's not going to be me.
Generalized.
Muhammad.
Thank you
about that. You cannot be a friend also. Okay. Then, that is question number one. When you are dealing with an event, the most important thing to do is to see if the event you are dealing with is severe or not. And I will tell you later on, 40% of refractory pediatric epilepsy are non-epileptic. And we'll talk about that in a minute. So the first question you are talking about was an event, a seizure. If you have an event, always ask, is the event a seizure or not? You can always history and physical exam, just like the medical school. When you think there's no rules, please stick with the basic rules. And we'll tell you more about this. History, you can ask the patient if he can answer you. Or a witness, a lot of the time I tell the family, would you please do me a favor and get the video for me? And this can make a whole world of difference in this day. Very important, loss of consciousness, loss of sphincter controlled hand biting, these all are indication that this might be seizure. Post-ictal state, eyes open or closed. Believe it or not, 95% of people who are seizing with the eyes are closed are psychogenic. So with eye closed, and you can diagnose psychogenic seizure, and they have seen it a lot. And history of spacing out and acting lost. A lot of the time, you know, the one of the public, the very common story I have a child, a neurologist, working at Ohio State University, 35 experience, he's among the most or the smartest neurologists I have ever seen. He was from Indian origin. His son was having seizure for 19 years, and he did not realize that. He said, oh, I thought he was in his own world. He was sitting and he was having seizure for 19 years until he had generalized tonic clonic seizure. When they did the EEG, there was a lot of spikes. Just took one EEG to diagnose. Now, history of CNS insult, infection, or injury, we have to rule this in pediatric. And family history, if the mom tells you, I have a seizure, my father has a seizure, three aunts are having a seizure, three paternal aunts have a seizure, do you think my son has a seizure? Of course he will have a seizure. Okay, because this is a very strong family history for primary generalized epilepsy. Now, what are the physical examination? Neurocutaneous finding, I always look for that. We'll talk about head circumference, micro or macro, that is always important. Wood lamb exam in infantile spasm looking for. Ash leaf spot, sometimes you have to examine the family. But if you examine the patient, I would be more than happy if I do it myself. This morphic feature or funny looking face. If you look at the kid and he does not look like his mom or his dad, you know there's something wrong. Now, this is a coffee or its spot, axillary prickling, neurofibromatosis, big one, iris hamartoma, as we see neurofibromatosis. So please, when you ask the family, I have seen a patient, she had a neurofibromatosis diagnosed 10 years ago. Her daughter has macrocephaly, seizure, cuff-related spots. I was asking her, this was in USA. Does anyone has your family has neurofibromatosis? No doctor, nobody. I tell them, anyone has lumps that has to be taken out? She said, yes, I used to have it. And they told her, please don't do that. She was diagnosed with neurofibromatosis 10 years ago, and she forget what was her diagnosis, the mom. So it's very important sometimes to tease out the history. Now, this is adenoma sebaceum, ash leaf. Very important in fair skin people to do wood lamp exam and chagrin batch and tuberous sclerosis. I wanna, this is beyond my control, a seizure is closed by Stuart Ross McCollum. This is to reinforce how important is neurology or how important when you lose your mind. I want you to live with me a few moments of strong emotions. So the guy was saying, you know, beyond my control, a seizure is a close. He is describing what was happening to him because of seizure. It is here again, the sinister sensation of an aura that I know only too well, searching for a safe place to lay down as I descend into my private hell. I shout out loud, it's happening again. It's beyond my control. Dropping down heavily, my head hits the floor. Feeling horrid, my mind and body is no longer in my control. Twitching, shaking, and staring into space, I black out. Arriving back to consciousness, all I can see are many pairs of shoes. He's on the floor, and people are around him. I began to apologize after what just happened. I have nothing to lose. Standing up, leaving my pride, and dignity back there on the ground. People began to walk away while some glanced back around. No need to feel so embarrassed. I keep telling myself nothing wrong with my state of mental health. It is beyond my control. I can't stop it. It and only it decide when I will suffer my next episode. So that is a guy who has been suffering from seizure. You know how much seizure can be devastating for a patient. Now, question number two. We decided this is a seizure. Now we're going to move to the question number two. Is the seizure provoked or unprovoked? I'm sorry, it has to be in slideshow. Can how
just
can I do?
Click.
So I can. Where's that? I didn't see it. So the second question, is it a provoked seizure or is it unprovoked seizure? You have, there is a mnemonic called vitamins. This vitamins is basically tell you what is the things that can...
Keep going.
Now one more. Yes, so vitamin. It could be vascular, stroke. You can have seizure with stroke. It can be infectious and in children. We have to be careful with that. Traumatic head injury, autoimmune, metabolic, iatrogenic, neoplastic, structural. Cortical dysplasia or heterotopia that can cause a seizure, and we can still call it epilepsy, even though. Very important message to take home. Unprovoked seizure within 24 hours of documented fever in a patient aged 1 month. To 6 years with no previous afebrile seizure, is febrile seizure until proven otherwise, after you rule out the CNS infection. It's very important. Now the seizure diagnosis, now we'll come to the black magic, our secret weapon, EEG. Why do I need to do EEG? It's very important to do an EEG. It helps diagnose seizure. I just told you about the guy who has seizing for 19 years. And we have seen people treated for multiple personality disorders. And when we do the EEG, they are on and off with seizure. I have seen it in one case myself. It classifies seizure. Is it partial onset? Is it generalized onset? It's very important to know because you need to choose the medication. Help in prognosis. If you have a 13 years old girl with spike waves and with myoclonic seizure and generalized tonic-clonic seizure, you know this girl had JME and she's going to be on medication pretty much for the rest of her life. It's very important, and guide the treatment. One of the things, two seizures. Infantile spasm, I would love, and I should, push for normalization of the EEG. Absence epilepsy, we do ambulatory hour, 24 hours, to make sure that they are absence seizure free, especially if they are driving. It's very important. Now, there's two types of EEG, ectal, when the patient is seizing, we hardly ever catch that, or intra-ectal, which is what we do all the time. Between episodes. The patient comes to you to the clinic, you do an EEG, he's not seizing. If you do one EEG, you capture 50% of the abnormality. If you do three EEG, you will capture 85% of the kids who have seizure. 15%, you will never ever have any intra-ectal abnormality. So three EEG is normal, does not rule out seizure. That's where we go to ambulatory EEG. Now, seizure diagnosis. What else I need to do? MRI of the brain until proven otherwise. It has to be done with every single patient. And please look at the MRI yourself, even if you don't know what you are looking at. I review every single MRI myself. I have to. Because a lot of the time, it's not normal, it's abnormal. It's not abnormal, it's not normal. We have brain herniation, it's normal. We have seen disasters. Now, there's something called long-term EEG monitoring, which is the video. They put the kid in the room. They put the video, they put the EEG, and monitor it. We don't have this luxury, but we have what we call ambulatory EEG. Small, fancy, dandy machine, put them on the side, hook the kid, send them home, come back, make sure you get their address, because it's expensive, the machine. They come back, we do a 24-hour, 48-hour EEG. And we have it in our clinical GLT. It's extremely helpful. This machine. Why we need to do that? Non-epileptic events, because a lot of the time, 40% of the refractory seizure, they are non-epileptic. I tell you about this story. I have a kid. I keep pushing the medication. I keep changing the medication, and he's not responding. And I don't have the luxury of doing the video EEG. So I did prolong the EEG. And of course, we come to the evidence, and they are absolutely non-epileptic. So we saved him off a medication. He had a seizure, but the event he was having, they are not seizure. So I kept him on his original dose, and I did not push up the dose or add another medication. Now, classify seizure type. A lot of the time, we don't know what we are dealing with. One of the kids woke up at the middle of the night, attacked the curtain, ripped them off, bring his brother up and throw him down on the floor, and he was treated as night terrors. Ambulatory EEG, frontal lobe epilepsy. And he was a big, low suitcase for the family. Because how come you did not do ambulatory? Because they're not going to tell you it's expensive. They want to know, how come you did not do it? So we treated him, yes, Muhammad, please.
How long do you usually send these kids with ambulatory EEG? Is there a threshold beyond which the sensitivity is high enough?
Excellent. We do, if you get the seizure or the typical event, you have to tell them the typical event within the first 24 hours, bring the patient back. If you don't capture it, go as long as, you know, the insurance approved, 2 or 3. We have done up to 96 hours, 5 days. We can, the machine we have, we can do up to 3 days. Now, as we said, we help diagnose the epilepsy, document improvement, as in the case of absence epilepsy, and we'll show you a case in a few minutes. And then we'll come to the fancy dandy studies that we don't have, unfortunately, in here. Or if we have it, we don't know how to interpret them very well. A spec, PET, MIG, we don't do them a lot yet. Now, this patient, hopefully it's going to work. Now.
I thought this spec would happen.
Yeah, but yeah, I mean, we can do it, but I don't know how helpful it is. This patient, hyperventilating, all of a sudden, look at the EEG, very nice, clean. She told him, snap your finger, nothing. You see?
Close his eyes.
Eyes are closed, it's excellent. Dr. Fadl, you got it. So now she will tell him. He told him, snap your finger, and he snapped his finger. So, based on that, guys, drug of choice for this patient is Solthia, Lamictal, Tubamax, Ethosuximide, Kibra. So it's a seizure.
None of the above.
None of the above, excellent. Who would vote for?
Say Valium.
Valium, yes, yes. Or
get him just marijuana.
Psychiatric counseling. So this is a typical absence epilepsy. The patient stop, snap your finger, he would not snap his finger, and right after the start, stop, snap your finger, he would snap his finger. So this is, drug of choice is ethosuximide, Zirantel or Dibakhi. Lamictal is a third choice, I didn't use it much. Now, the question number three, we know it's a seizure, we know it's unprovoked, what type of a seizure, okay? You know, as a simple country epileptologist or child neurologist, I still classify it as focal onset, start in one place and separate down, this is focal onset. Or generalized onset. The focal onset, we'll talk about more about them. Simple consciousness preserved. The patient's awake, but he sees it, right? Typical binaural epilepsy. The patient's twitching, but he's awake, he can't communicate, he's drooling. Or complex consciousness impaired. You don't have to lose your consciousness completely, and that's a challenge. Plus, minus, automatism. And either one of these can secondarily generalize. And if it's secondarily consciousness by definition, if you have bilateral involvement of the cerebral hemisphere, or if you are twitching on both sides, by definition, you have to be unconscious, except in one and two seizure. If it is psychogenic or the true seizure, the only true seizure that can cause is supplementary motor seizure, which is very rare. Probably in another lecture we'll show that. You can seize bilateral, but you're still awake. Except only the seizure will do that supplementary motor cortex seizure. Okay? Now, this is our secret weapon. You know, this is the reference. So, frontopolar, frontal, temporal, central, occipital, even, right, odd left. So, she has right temporal, mid temporal, posterior temporal discharge. Very easy. You really don't have to do training to read that. Very simple, right? Now, the generalized seizure. Generalized seizure, from the beginning, bilateral involvement, you should lose your consciousness. No way around it, except the supplementary motor cortex. So tonic, sustained contraction, clonic, tonic-clonic combination. Atonic, you collapse. All of a sudden, you collapse and hit the floor. You don't jerk and hit the floor. You collapse and hit the floor. Okay? Atonic, this is myoclonic, sudden, fast, involuntary movement. You do this. That's this is myoclonic. And absence, sudden, brief, and consciousness, as we say. This is an EEG in generalized seizure. Start everywhere at the same time. If you tell me this is a girl is 12 years old, I'll tell you this is abnormal generalized spike pulse, spike wave discharges, most likely consistent with juvenile myoclonic epilepsy. And drug of choice is dipaquine in girls. I would stay away from that. Now, anybody know what's that? How do you say it? Colossia? No, I don't know. Colossia. Okay. It used to be covered here in the old days, and they used people here used to fight to death.
Gladiators.
Yes, I forget the word. Gladiator. They fight. Lion against human being, human being against human being. You know, they fight, and the problem with the fight is fight until death. You have to die. No way around. Okay.
One of them had to die, not both.
What is that?
One of them had to die.
Absolutely, but the second he go for a second round. Okay, right. So when they die, they drag them through these doors. They drag them, they are bleeding. What they do, they run and collect the blood before they go through these doors. Here. Do you know, anybody know why do they collect the blood?
Yes. Sometimes they did blood therapy, especially for some people who were vampires and all, used to do blood therapy.
Excellent, because this was the drug of choice for seizure at that age. Drug of choice for seizure, blood collected from a gladiator dying and bleeding, being dragged through the windows. Salem witch trial. This happened in the 1600s. The people who had epilepsy, they were thought they are doing witchcraft. So what they did, some of them were beheaded here. Some of them were fired to death, right? And some of them, they were stoned, and some of them continued to seize for later days. So that is what some of the history about seizure treatment. I promise you, we're not going to do this to your patients, so don't be scared to send them to me. Now, very important, and I want to emphasize this big part, treatment principles. When you think you are in the middle of area or time of no rules, go to the basic rules, please. Treatment principle. Treat underlying etiology if it is known. That's why you need to do an EEG, MRI, or if there's infection, you need to do LP. Extremely important. Establish correct seizure time. Why? Because you're going to match the drug to the seizure time. Begin with one drug to max. Change up to 3 before combination. We just, in the last 2 weeks, had 2 patients, one of them refractory epilepsy. 60 seizures a day over 2 months. 60. My colleagues consulted me. I 60. He was seen by so many physicians. You know, I am a simple country epileptologist. What can I do? I don't have, you know, the crystal ball. So I found out that he's on 3 months, 4 seizure medications, none of them on the max dose. We took that drug of choice and we pumped it up. Within 48 hours, the patient was seizure free. You see how important to push the medication to the max. Don't add another medication. This is extremely common. If you happen to have a seizure patient, look at their medication and look at that dose. You will find 3 or 4 medications, none of them at the max dose. This week, we got another patient. He's also in the hospital. He has been seizing 1 or 2 times since for the last 2 months. And the patient was, the dad was in the hospital. We just pushed one medication up to the max. The patient was seizure free. Since admission. It's a simple trick. Just push to the max. Don't add another medication. Now, based dose on body weight, yes, because we are pediatric, use drug level as appropriate. Okay? Be aware of age-specific issue. If she is 12 years old, don't put her in dipaquine, because it can cause hirsutism, it can cause obesity, it can cause polycystic ovary syndrome, and if she gets pregnant in the Western country, it is the worst seizure medication for pregnant lady. Now, counsel patient about seizure, precaution. Please think about the driving restriction. There are states, in the United States, they can drive at 14. Please tell the family, you cannot drive until you are seizure free for 6 months. Write it on the chart, write it on the wall, write it in your phone, because it is very important. I will tell you why. And medication side effect, tell them about it. Tell them, you know, the vaccine might elevate your liver enzyme. Because if the liver enzyme elevated, it could be reversible. You're going to be the worst child.
Because it was 2 years, why it's brought down to 6 months now? Because it's to be 2 years seizure free, then you can drive. But why it's not 6 months? Any especially?
No, it's dependent on the state. Some states are 3 months, some states are 4 months, some states are 6 months.
No, but because it's to be 2 years in many countries.
Yes, yes. But in the state, it depends. Yeah, the state where I used to practice, it was 6 months. I 6 months or higher. Okay? Now, I'll tell you about the medication. You know, luckily we have almost 20 seizure medication. We have a luxury of medication. I'm going to tell you about 5. Valproate, Depakine, Lamotrigine, Keppra, Levetiracetam, my favorite, I call it vitamin K. I love it to death. Topramine and Zonisamide. These are broad spectrum anti-seizure medication. You can use them for partial, you can use them for generalized onset. Okay? Drug of choice for partial onset seizure. Not vitamin D, not Depakine, Trileptin, Oxcarbazepine. Depakine is being used left and right on every single patient here. And every time you send me a patient Depakine, I'll be more than happy to see the patient, but I will take him off the Depakine and put another medication, Trileptin. I have been here less than 2 years. I might change my practice, but this is the way I usually do it. Go for partial onset, Trileptin, Oxcarbazepine, or if they don't have money, you can go for Tegretol. Okay? Now, my tricks, neonate, phenobarbital, phenytoin, and Keppra. Keppra, avoid the psychiatric patient because they can become crazy in you and you don't want to do that, okay? Depakine, avoid in less than 2 years, which is usually here, is used in less than 2 years. And adolescent girls, Tubamax, good for overweight. If she's 200 kilo, you might want to put in Tubamax. So when she lose a little weight and she's going to be happy with you, or he's going to be happy. Lamictal good in delayed depressed and bipolar because it's a mood stabilizer. It will stabilize the mood, okay? Now, we said, you know, you really have to document the seizure precautions and you tell the family about it. This is a lady, she's driving a Mercedes, you know, and this is a poor guy. He's walking across the street. The traffic light is red. He has a bag and he's walking. All of a sudden, he's flying. His bag is flying. And she has no clue what is happening. Can you see? Has no clue. This is the patient with seizure. She had seizure. That's captured on the in reality. And if you look at here, lights on and nobody is on. And luckily, she was even listening to music. And I'll tell you which music she was listening to. And here I come. Up. She was listening to Mr. she was feeling good, but this guy apparently was not feeling good at all. He was a fly. So this is why you have to document in the chart, don't drive before 6 months seizure free. Okay? Other epilepsy treatment, you know, surgery, location, like real estate. If seizure always comes from the left and the right hand is seizing, I do MRI, there's abnormality in the left, you know, you might want to tunnel him to somebody who does the surgery if he's not well controlled. What about the ketogenic diet? You know, tell 40% of the patient. It is not normal or natural, and there's the vagal nerve stimulator. 50% of the patient will have more than 50% improvement in their seizure. After you look at their medication and after you maximize their medication and make sure they are not on 3 medications, none of them is near the highest dose. Okay? Now, as I have shown you to the lecture, healthy mind, healthy body. They say healthy body, healthy mind. I say healthy mind is a healthy body. And unhealthy mind, even in a healthy body, will ultimately destroy your health. And Manny P. Hall is the one who said that. You guys have any questions? This is conclude the first part.
I think we better go to the second one at the end because we'll be late for dinner.
No, that's in English. We are going to be in time. I don't miss out with food. Okay. Non-epileptic paroxysmal event. ELA defined it as clinical manifestation is presented to be unrelated to an abnormal and excessive discharge, which is a seizure, of a set of neurons of the brain, including disturbance in brain function, or pseudoseizure. Basically, it's any event that does not correlate or does not have a neuronal erosion in the brain. Okay? Paroxysmal event, it can be epileptic, tunnel them to me. It can be non-epileptic, psychologic, you send them psychiatrist, organic or physiologic, you might want to tunnel them to Dr. Muhammad Hamdan for pediatric cardiology, because it can cause that. Facts. I want you to just pay attention to the fact, at least if you can. The misdiagnosis of epilepsy in children with refractory seizure is as high as 40%. Can you believe that? That is, when you come, or when I do an ambulatory EEG or video EEG, and it costs the family 5,000 dirham, you know, it might save a whole lot of stress and a whole lot of psychogenic impact on the kid. Believe me, it is as high as 40%, and this is quoted from Abed and Mikat. It's very important to make sure what we are dealing with is a seizure. Large population of children, they are unnecessarily subjected to the burden of treatment because they are non-epileptic. Epileptic and non-epileptic paroxysm, they kind of present the same way. And infants are very prone to developing non-epileptic episodes because they are immature in their neurons, in their brain. Okay? Here, this is, and I put this one here. I know it's a busy slide. I do apologize for that, but I put it. And the reason for that, I want to see, this is a simple chart. Tell you, there is non-epileptic event that come as generalized paroxysm and drop attacks. Some of them come as jerk and abnormal posture, oculomotor abnormality, and sleep disorder, and divided based on age. So if you have an infant with abnormal generalized paroxysm, you can think about apnea, hyperecplexia, as a non-epileptic event, okay? For example, if you have a kid with oculomotor abnormality, you can have paroxysmal tonic upward gaze deviation. Please make sure you are not missing obstaclonus microns. We just diagnosed like towards the last year with just the typical thing, it's conjugate, chaotic, abnormal movement of the brain. It has to be conjugate together, okay? Here, tell you how you can, you know, differentiate between, for example, vasovagal or syncopal attack, okay? And between the other psychogenic disorders. One of the things that I find very helpful and we'll discuss in the coming video, eye closed or open, and have the thrusting, side-to-side movement, okay, and fatigability, and I'll show you in a minute. Now, this is a case I have encountered in Ohio State. I wasn't called as a fellow, and they called us, and they called the consultant child neurologist on call for sudden onset right hemiplegia, dense hemiplegia, which I mean subcortical, internal capsule, completely paralyzed, okay, everything, aphasic, and they did the head CAT scan we do in the acute stroke to make sure there's no bleeding. We are not dealing with a tumor that tipped the kid over. And when I came in, that child neurologist, doctor, one of our attending, was having special protocol for using TPA in children. So that's a typical case, right? Yeah, and how often do you see that? Like, you know, once every blue moon. So he was discussing with the family what are the side effects and what we should do, and the physical finding completely fit with the acute stroke, no one would, you know, fault you. But I want you guys to choose, what would you do next? First, give him TBA, as we don't want to lose the window period. It's a stroke, until proven otherwise. The window period is 3 hours, right? CT is normal, there's no hemorrhage. We're not dealing with brain tumor, we're going to give him TBA. I would like to open quick diffusion-weighted MRI to confirm the diagnosis. This is the, you know, a special cut in the MRI we call diffusion weighted, and here the stroke. Look at the stroke. It will show up like this. Very simple. Go to diffusion weighted, you will see it is a stroke. Of course, there is a lot of into it, but this is simple. I need more history. Second opinion, you might want to call me Dr. Hamdan to see if it's cardiac or not. None of the above.
Was it a boy or a girl?
He was a boy.
I need more history.
Absolutely.
More history.
More history. Yeah, go to the basic history, basic exam. What kind of history do you want?
Well, was there a debilitating event?
Yes.
Okay. Has this happened before? Is this the first episode?
Was there a history of trauma? And then physical examination.
Excellent. That's what I want to do. I need more history. The one thing, you know, again, I would not fault, a general pediatrician or internal medicine who can see this once every blue moon to do, go ahead and think about TBA. We came and we asked the family one question. We told them, do you guys have headache in the family? They said, yes, I have a migraine. And his answer, and that is, yes, they do have migraines. Then, we talked to the consultant, we might want to hold on.
We have a hemiplegic migraine for
the... It was hemiplegic migraine. This case was hemiplegic migraine. So history and physical exam, extremely important, okay? So a hemiplegic migraine, a rare type of migraine, they come with typical stroke-like episode. Usually you need to make sure you evaluate them with MRI to exclude stroke and at least diffusion-weighted images. Plus you need to do an EEG, why? To rule out thought paralysis. So it is a diagnosis of exclusion, but if you want to do invasive step, you might as well do diffusion weighted image to document it's a stroke.
No, okay? Role of carotid angiogram.
What is that?
Carotid angiogram, because something moyo can also present like the same.
Right. But this kid went back to normal and he had another episode 2-3 months later, but we know. We said, we have been around the block. Okay, give him migraine treatment and he did fine. Now, this is a very lovely infant.
And as you guys see here, she is sitting there with her mom. I want you to watch. Oh, she jerked.
So, diagnosis, infantile colic, paroxysmal tonic up gauge deviation, okay? Sandy Fire syndrome, infantile spasm, benign necrosis of infancy. Who would say infantile spasm? Hands up. Who would say it's benign myoclonic for infancy? Okay. Zin. So this patient was benign myoclonus of infancy. But those who said it's infantile spasm, you can be right. Why? How do I find out? Because she did this one.
Yeah.
The age comes. She did like this. The EEG would be normal. So that's very helpful. Now I will show you this case. What is that? I repeat it? Sure, I can. Look at the second one. You did that? So it looks like it's infantile spasm,
yeah.
But basically it is not. Because the EEG, how do I know? The EEG is normal. I did the EEG, it's normal. Okay, now.
What is the clinching factor in favor of myoclonus?
EEG normal. Normal development, normal kid, normal brain. So this kid is basically, let me play the video. I want you guys to see this one. So what is that? But this is not the question. The question is, what would you do next? Right? I would obtain EEG, and if EEG is normal, I would obtain 24 hours video versus ambulatory EEG. Observation and follow-up in 1 week. Brain MRI. You start United Kingdom infantile spasm protocol, high dose steroid, my favorite, or none of the above.
Show us again.
Obtain EEG.
Brain MRI.
Brain MRI, excellent.
EEG.
And if it is normal, okay.
Yeah.
One of the, Dr. Thiel, she is at Boston Children's Hospital. She, one time she said, I think it's infantile spasm. The kid already bought 24 hours with EEG. Because early, the EEG can be normal. And usually the early sign you see in the EEG, posterior, predominant, abnormal child waves. And it can completely normal. So if you think about it, go for ambulatory EEG. Why? Because this is a seizure where we can make a difference. I have a few kids, I follow up them till now, they develop 6 months infantile spasm, now they are in the third grade developmental level. I have seen a kid 6 months ago, by seeing one of my colleagues, not Charlie Rose, a pediatric, and he thought it's a colic. We did an EEG, it's crazy. It is typical hip zap. Okay. Usually 4 to 6 months, incident, flexor, extensor, or mixed, Usually EEG show Hibbs arrhythmia, and I will show you that interictally. Most frequent ectal manifestation, electrodecremental response. Sudden attenuation of the background. Treatment ACTH. My favorite United Kingdom infantile spasm protocol, 10 milligram QID for 2 weeks. With no improvement after 1 week, I bump it up to 60 milligram, and I have zero patient who did not respond so far. And it's very cheap, cost like probably 100 dirham. In America, ACTH was costing $100,000. And this protocol would cost, they bumped it up, because it's what they call orphan drug. So they have to bump it up. It costs $100,000. And while the steroid, it would cost you probably less than $200. Okay? That's Hibbs arrhythmia. What do I mean by Hibbs arrhythmia? This is attenuated. If you're going to pull it a full gain, it will all interlace. If you read the EEG this way, or if you flip it over, it does not make any difference. High amplitude, disorganized, background, with poor synchrony between the right and left hemisphere. You can't see this in normal EEG, if you compare with the old one. Okay? Now, this lovely lady, she was captured on EEG. They start doing photic stimulation. And all of a sudden, she started to seize. Okay, she is telling her, memorize the word can or whatever word. Okay? Enough? Diagnosis, pseudo seizure, partial onset seizure with rapid generalization, gelastic seizure, syncopal attack, none of the above.
Pseudo
seizure. Any other alternative? Okay. Eyes were closed, right? She was having hip thrusting, you know? It was fatigable, she would not go rhythmic, she was fatigable, and on top of that, she was having left to right head thrusting. That is typical pseudo seizure. I would have diagnosed her even without doing a video EEG. Now, I would just take a few minutes to let you know that we would like you guys to join our mailing list from the American Child Neurology OAE. We send the latest articles in neurology, metabolic, genetic, and neurodevelopmental to all people who subscribe freely. We send it every month. And also, this lecture, and we have more than 60 lectures, including the latest pediatric neurology conference, the latest epilepsy conference, recorded and ready to view free on our website. The username, Lee Amra, and the password for the video and for to come to see the lectures is 444. And the show. Keep this on. Please, now can we go for questions? Any question, guys? Comments?
For the infantile spasms and this myoclonic seizures, how do you differentiate?
Yes. Normal development, normal physical examination, no developmental regression, very important. Okay.
Myoclonic.
Yeah. And if you are in doubt, it would not have to be an EEG. Please. Would not have to be an EEG. But usually in infantile spasm, they have developmental regression. But not necessarily. But this patient, you know, you play her, would examine her and see her, no regression. She's completely normal. Physical exam is completely normal. And I tell you, I have seen all what they have told you in infantile spasm. So if you have doubt, get an EEG. As simple as it will solve your problem and it will cover your back.
And EEG with the first episode?
Wallahi, if I think about infantile spasm, I don't miss out. Believe me, this is the seizure where we can make a big difference. And I tell you, I have 3 or 4 patients from the first dose, they completely resolve, and one of them is 8 years old and he's completely healthy. If he is developmentally normal before the attack, if there's no developmental regression, if there's no structural MRI abnormality or genetic abnormality, usually the prognosis is excellent. And they grow up normal. I pulled a study from Israel done on all the kids who did not have developmental regression, all the kids who did not have abnormal MRI, plus abnormal MRI, plus no genetic abnormality, 100% with infantile spasm, they become normal.
With the cryptogenic has a better prognosis or the other one?
What is that?
The cryptogenic infantile spasm has a better prognosis or the other one has a better prognosis?
The genetic?
Cryptogenic infantile spasm.
Yes, that's
has no underlying.
Yeah, the idiopathic has much better prognosis. Especially
so you have to start very early, yes?
Yes.
Within 3 weeks.
Excellent.
They start the treatment within 3 weeks. I have seen kids jerking for 4 months or 5 months before this one. See us. See us. Please.
Dr. Hamza, in your previous presentation, you said to abort a seizure, you use a single dose to the maximum. Maximum.
What, one medication?
Yeah, one medication.
You push
single medication to push up the
start low. And
does it, my question is, does it cause respiratory depression sometimes when you use that
right.
medication to a maximum dose?
Absolutely not.
In children?
I have never seen that. With benzodiazepines, if you go fast, it might. But none of the long-term medication are benzodiazepines. Did they make them drowsy? Yes. They would be drooling, they would be drowsy, they would be sleepy, the mom would be in your pocket wiggling, my kid is sleeping, you know, I can't wake him up, I tell him, just calm down. Give him time, and 3 weeks later, they don't even show up for the expect, no. And I have been through it. Other question, guys? Then I will hand the presentation to my buddy here. Thank you very much for your time. It's closing.